Welcome back to The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. Time for us to check out the big stories on our national dailies. I'll start off with the Daily Independent newspaper this morning. And to make sense of all of this, we do have an analyst, Jide Johnson, joining us to help us understand all of the stories on the front pages of our national dailies.
Morning, Jide Johnson.
Good morning. Good morning to you. Good morning to all of our viewers all over the world. Thank God it's Friday.
All right. So I start off with the Daily Independent newspaper this morning. On the front page of the Daily Independent, the bold caption reads, "Our engagement with IPOP, bandit, not biased." That's what the military is quoted to say. "Our engagement with IPOP and bandits, not biased." Military is quoted to say, and you find details on page 28. "Confirms death of ruthless ISWAP leader Al Banawi." That's the first rider you find. Another rider says terrorists not infiltrating the FCT, that's Abuja. "Six remaining Tucano jets delivered September 28. And so we're looking at 12, and we hope that that helps with the fight against insurgency. Moving away from that, another bold story says, 2023 presidency, no vacancy. Wait till 2031. Pandev tells nothing politicians." I'm sure that's going to be, a response to that particular one. 2022 budget, reps raise concern over Naira devaluation. It's also on the top page of the Daily Independent. You find that on page 28, to be precise. "Pass budget for second reading." Okay, that's what you find. Away from that, another interesting headline reads, "Anambra Gubia elections. IGP orders deployment of 34,587 policemen, three helicopters and dogs." Well, let's see how things actually pans out on the 6th of November. Underneath you find Supreme Court affirms Soludo as ABGA candidate. And that's it also. You have several riders. I'm sure you want to check that out on page 2 of the Daily Independent newspaper. Now, see, looking at the front page of the Daily Independent, just before we move away quickly, U.S. sends fresh 3,577,860 COVID-19 vaccine doses to Nigeria. It's on page 28. And you also have Osibanjo urges Nigeria's subnational, so think-alikes, although think-alike, I beg your pardon. NCC says 5G deployment 97% ready. Federal government asks TV station to feature sign language and interpreters, and that's on page 29. Well, that's so much we can take on the Daily Independent newspaper.
All right, moving on to the Punch newspapers, and starting with the PDP's chairmanship. It says, IU's emergence as chair. North gets PDP's nod to contest 2023 presidency. It was put in black and white that North Central could contest, says Baraje. North can't produce president, chairman same time, says George. Also, we're set to auction spectrum for 5G deployment, says the NCC. National Assembly proposes December 15th for budget passage, threatens MDAs. And also, senior staff caution federal government on unvaccinated workers ban. Government plans mass vaccination. Still on the Punch this morning, 88,704 cholera or contract cholera, 3,208 die amid vaccine scarcity. And Oshimbajo urges creativity by states on revenue generation. Buhari once took part in protest, shouldn't disrupt NSARS, says Femi Falana. And force headquarters, three choppers, 34,587 cops to police Anambra governorship election. I'll take that again. Force headquarters, three choppers and 34,587 cops to police Anambra governorship election. Ogu motorist hospitalized after checkpoint shooting. Cop arrested. Military expects more Tucano jets October 28th, says bandits are fleeing the northwest. And also, Deputy Vice Chancellor Adebowale emerges UI new VC. Those are the ones on the Punch this morning.
All right, away from the Punch newspaper this morning, let's check out the Leadership newspaper. And the bold caption reads, Racketeering slows down 6 million mass metering project. That's the bold caption on the Leadership newspaper. Details available on page 4. Only 750,000 meters deployed 1 year after takeoff. Darkness looms as gas producers threaten to cut supply. It's also on page 4. Presidency. Wait till 2031. Pandev tells Northerners. And that's what you find on, that's on page 19. Away from that, you have the PDP chairmanship. IU emerges nothing consensus candidate. I'd like to take that again. PDP chairmanship, IU emerges Northern Consensus candidate. It's on page 4. Anambra poll, Supreme Court affirms Soludo as ABGA candidate. Military confirms death of ISWAP leader. That's also on page 5. It's dominating all of the front pages of a national dailies. That's the much we can take on the Leadership newspaper this morning.
And finally, on the Daily Trust, El-Rufai's metropolitan authorities stir controversy. Local government areas' power usurped to co-fund new tiers. PDP says it's duplication of responsibility. Lawyers vary. And also on the Daily Trust, presidency, wait till 2031, Pandev tells Northerners. Don't threaten us, says the NEF. APC Congress, Ganduje tackles Shekarau and others over petition. We can also find on the Daily Trust newspapers, reps summon CBN, finance ministry overstalled $3.1 billion e-customs projects. Buhari seeks UNDP's intervention to resettle IDPs. And PDP chair, how are you emerged consensus candidate? 1 month after Daily Trust report, military confirms ISWAP leader dead. Judy Johnson, good morning once again. Thanks for joining us.
It's a pleasure to be with you. Good morning to our viewers.
All right, so I want us to start with the story that I took on the Anambra elections, where it says three helicopters, 34,587 cops to police Anambra governorship election. Let's get your thoughts on that first before we move on.
But that's the trend. When an election is coming, we know it. That's when we know that the IGP is active with deployment of the resources to protect lives and property. You begin to wonder if, while we were young, we used to see police helicopter doing surveillance all over Lagos, but we only hear about police helicopters during election, particularly during this off-cycle election. That's when the police will mobilize the personnel to cover the whole of Anambra State. Just imagine if these resources have been used prior to the election. Some of the security challenges we are having in the Southeast and some of the backlash the military are getting in terms of the treatment of the locals and the comparison of relating that to the story that the military had to come up with a statement to say that the engagement with IPOB and Banti are not biased. So I just wonder that we could have such security, and then when election comes, to mobilize them, and under normal circumstances, we find it so hard to mobilize the men and women and officers of the Nigerian police to provide security. So it's true to type. Basically, there's a budget for it. Basically, just follow the money. The numbers you are seeing has to also do with resources. Resources will be allocated for each of the police officers that are mobilized. And allowances hopefully will be paid to them, and hopefully they will get the allowance. But it's true to type when election is coming. The year 60,000, 70,000, 80,000, three helicopters, dogs, all of these will be released. And then you wonder, why can't we do this? Why can't this just be the norm in terms of providing security for this nation? So for me, I'm not surprised. When you just look at the media headlines of newspaper preceding elections, and you see that this is the consistent pattern, and that's where we have been. That does not stop the violence from erupting in the election in the past. Hopefully, we pray it will not happen this time around, or people snatching ballot boxes and the rest of it. So, let's just hope. I don't want to be an atheist that we should take prayer out of it, but let's just hope, because Nigerians are the most prayerful set of people. Today they will go to mosque. Tomorrow and Sunday they will go to church. If it is by prayer, all of our problems should be solved. But everyone else, those who help themselves, if we don't take decisive action, I said there is no amount of prayer we can pray that can solve the problem. But I think this should be the norm when it comes to deployment of security. It doesn't have to be tied to election law.
Okay, still on that particular issue that's been raised on the dailies this morning, do you think that that's going to encourage participation in the election, the fact that the presence of security is going to be on the high? Do you think that will actually encourage the people to come out to cast their vote? Or you think that that might just discourage them, cause fear, looking at all of the security concerns in the southeastern region?
Well, the election is a double-sided issue. It's a double-edged position that we have found ourselves. I have argued over time that our election is over-militarized. By the time you wake up in the morning of the election, it's like the nation is under siege. The atmosphere is tense. Actually, in the night preceding the election, you find it practically difficult for you to move. And then if you are in my generation and you witnessed a military intervention, the various military coups, the money of our the night preceding our elections and the money of our elections look like change of government during military regime. It's over-militarized. That itself discourages people from coming out because there's this morbid fear. You just see the atmosphere. We watch election in other climes, in other society. Election is like people are celebrating. Everybody goes about their normal businesses. So it doesn't look like the nation is under siege. And we have argued that why can't we have elections during the week and that people can go to work and then come back, cast their ballots before they go to work and come back. But that's the way we do things. And for me, I agree with you. It creates fear. It's only the bold ones that actually can go out and vote for the election. And the irony of it is that, yet, despite this heavy deployment of security, we still have challenges with violence, elections being marked with violence, with ballot box snatching. And at the end of the day, when you even have that security, which will have been in the night of the election, to protect the integrity of the election, which has to do with the announcement of result. In most cases, most of these military people will have gone back to their police and the rest of them will have gone back to their base. You ask yourself the question, why would you deploy custom, deploy immigration, deploy all of these agencies? That's the police we have read. If you participate in the election, the NCDC people will be deployed. And then you ask yourself, what is custom, what is immigration, what is doing during concerning the election? But that is the way it is, and that is what we have found ourselves, what it actually affects. Let me just quickly tie that to the story of the emergence of Soludo, the court case, and the Supreme Court decision. And I think this is the way we should go. We should get judgment. Pre-election matters should be treated before the election. Now everybody can go to bed. Everybody is sure. The Anambra electorates are not confused as to whether Abga has two candidates or not. The issue of PDP has been resolved with the candidature EU resolved. That of Abga too has been resolved. And I think this is the way we should go. I think the Supreme Court should be commended for this and so that this pre-election material issues are treated and then we know the candidate before the election. People actually know who they are voting for in the morning of the election, which preceding the election. I think it's a welcome development.
All right. Also speaking now, since we started the conversation talking about the police, let's now move, still talking about the police, to reactions to the seeming, NSAR's memorial, and of course the Nigerian and Lagos State government's, Lagos State Commissioner of Police also reactions to it. It's in the news this morning on the Punch from Femi Falana saying that President Muhammadu Buhari protested in Nigeria and carried out or participated in protests and so should allow the NSAR's protesters to, carry out their memorial if they choose to here in Lagos or across the country. Share your thoughts on that one. I've heard Hakim Odumosu here in Lagos State say that they would not allow any form of protesting in Lagos to, of course, like they always say, avoid a repeat of what happened last year.
The majority will always have their say way that, and the minority must have their say. The expression of divergent opinion and in it is the critical element for the polity in democracy. Everyone has a right. I have the right. It's my fundamental right to protest. To protest about what government is doing that I feel I don't. I don't like. And but in the course of that protest, my right must not trample on other people's right. It must not violate. What the police should do when there is protest is even to protect those that are protesting, so that some unscrupulous elements do not manipulate the process. What we have had in Nigeria is that in the course of the protest, the vision of the protest is hijacked by some unscrupulous element that lead to vandalism and the rest of it. But don't also forget that the state authorities have a role to play. What do I mean? That's the security. We shouldn't be hearing issues from security agencies when it comes to protest. What is the opinion, the views of Lagos State Government itself that the police commissioner works under with when it comes to protest? Protest is a key component part of democracy. That it's you can't stop it. It's a fundamental human right. But what do we have? We have a situation whereby the police structure is centralized, controlled from Abuja. Even the police commissioner himself cannot take decision on his own. He has to get directive from Abuja. But if the police commissioner is responsible to the governor of the state, then the governor of the state cannot control over that. For me, I don't think anybody under the constitution of Nigeria in a democracy can stop protest or rally. But that rally must not lead to violence. That's where the police comes in, to ensure that there's maintenance of law and order. And to a large extent, if you see the aftermath of NSAS, if you are heading security agencies in Lagos, you'll be much more concerned because there are vandalization, destruction of lives and property. So as a result of that, you want to prevent that. However, for me, and what is normal globally, is for the police to provide protection for people that want to protest and not to stifle protest. And like Ifemi Falana said, Buhari was part of a protest in Abuja. There was nothing that happened to him. I remember the Save Nigerian protest that happened. Majority of the people in government today participated in the process. And why are they scared of dissent? Dissent is part of democracy. You must tolerate opposing views.
Okay, let's quickly look at the Daily Independent newspaper this morning. The bold caption carries the story where the military is clarifying the fact that their engagement with IPOP and the bandits has no sentiment. And that's because over time, some quarters actually believe that the military is more like a witch hunt. So there's a witch hunt on this set of people. That's the IPOP. But that's one. And the other one is also the fact that, yes, they're saying that the ISWAP leader, Al Banawi, is dead. What do you make of all of this?
Well, it's clear the way bandits have been treated in Nigeria and the way people calling for self-agitation have been treated. And the way people that have identified with self-determination have been treated. Why bandits and Boko Haram have been called repentant and they are gathered together and they are welcome and there's a conciliatory approach. You see that the approach towards IPOP and particularly what cuts the eye of most people is even people calling for self-determination. People wearing colors to represent the nation that they believe they should belong to. Is that the right of self-determination? It's a fundamental human right. The way the military, so for the military to come out to say that, you know that the military is facing a perceptual problem, is facing an image problem, and that's why they are trying to, we are not treating, but it's clear, everybody can see, it's in the public domain, it is in the public domain. Let's take the issue of that Nollywood actor that was arrested, the way he was treated, and see the way bandits have been treated, and you begin to wonder, do we have true approach to dealing with issues in this country? Are there true laws made from, is it an animal farm country where you have one law for some people and then another law. The approach of the military must be consistent. And if it's not consistent in the eye of the public will question the intention of the military. And the military will be faced with coming out to say, oh, our engagement with IPOB and bandits is not biased. But it's very clear that we've seen bandits talking to governors and the police surrounding them. We have not seen government engaging people calling for. Has government engaged with people calling for self-determination? No. But government, governors across the northwest and across the northeast have engaged with bandits and terrorists. So, and Boko Haram, so you don't need this statement if you are being fair. Someone said you don't need to remember anything if you are telling the truth, because you know the truth at all times.
All right. Also speak about the your PDP's chairmanship. And of course, the reactions to it. I use emergence as chair. North gets PDP's nod to contest 2023 presidency. It also says here, North can't produce president and chairman at the same time, says Bode George. It was put in black and white that North Central could contest, says Baraje. Share your thoughts on that one also, and where we seem to be heading.
Well, when I had the news, I told a friend and a colleague, I said, that has made the presidency of the PDP open to the northeast and to the northwest and to other parts of the country. And I said that why must it be someone from Benue? And then why should it be Yocha Ayu? And the more things seem to change, the more they remain the same. These have been actors and players that have been part and parcel. What have you heard of Ayu in the last 6-7 years? And then all of a sudden he emerged. And I told that my colleague, because we came home yesterday together. I said, Manamba Asgamadi, Audu Ogbe, you know, I've been PDP chairman. They are both from Benue State. At the initial stage, we thought that it was David Mark. But if you understand the dynamics of the local politics of Benue State, the TV, Idoma, Igala, Igede's dimension, you understand when that was. And all of a sudden, we just saw the emergence of the name of Yocha Ayu. I told some that Yocha Ayu clinched it and that they call not a strategy. After the PDP's meeting, how many meetings were held in the Abuja, the state house of Bauchi? How many meetings were held by the Northern? Shortly after the PDP national meeting, they went into the enclave and they had this Northern leaders meeting. And it's made it open for the North. Because one, Yocha Ayu, whatever cards you want to play, they play. Yocha Ayu is a Christian. Two, is from the Middle Belt. It is when it comes to some certain issue that you understand that, oh, it's the Middle Belt. When it's political expedient, the Middle Belt becomes Middle Belt. And then it becomes the North, depending on whatever they want to achieve at time. I have not always believed in the issue of rotational presidency. I think that we should have the best to run this country. However, we have started with an arrangement, because every nation, every organization leads by precedent procedures, and that becomes a policy. By precedence, what we have had in the two major parties is power shifting, even though it's not in the 1999 constitution as amended, moving from the North to the South. And I've said it, if you are even talking about the South, it would be injustice for the Southwest to want to claim the presidency, because the Southeast, by order, the South should have the first shot, the South-South should have the second shot, and the Southwest should have the third shot concerning it. So they played the master card, they played the master stroke, and it has made it open to all. I hope PDP will be able to manage the crisis to come out of it, because it was, when that was done, it was not said whether the presidency will come from the North or the South, but it was that the chairmanship has been zoned to the North. And we have seen that the North is playing its political masterstroke once again. And Benue is always in the spotlight of all of this. So in the history of PDP, three chairmen will have come from Benue. From Benue State, so it's divided now. And it's
what do they stand? What are the chances, you know, if they eventually pick a candidate still from the North, seeing that Ayu is from the Middle Belt?
We have seen that. They said Nigeria was divided along under Jonathan that became polarized and the APC government promised unity. But you agree that the issue for self-determination was very, very high under Buhari's administration. And then in terms of the skewness of the appointment, the lack of regard for federal character, and the sheer nepotistic approach to giving appointments to people that come from a certain section of this country, that itself awakened the need for Nigerians to call for self-consciousness. And nobody cares where the presidency come from in the past, but with the experiences we have had, has created that, and everybody seems to think that, oh, my to your turn to Israel, I'm better served if I'm represented by someone from my primary. And I've said it, it's just a sheer waste of time. It's an illusion if you think that will happen, because the presidency has come from Katsina State. It has not helped Katsina. True, yeah, Adua and Buhari has gone. The presidency has come from Bayelsa State. Just travel between rivers and Bayelsa, you see the state of the road and look at the infrastructure. The presidency has come from Ogun State. What has it done to Lagos Abeokuta Expressway? If you want to go to Ilaro, the best way for you to go is to go to Sango, but you spend the whole of your life going to Ilaro. So you have to go through Lagos Ibadan Expressway and then connect Abeokuta to go to it. So what has Obasanjo Ijea presidency done for Ogun State? The presidency coming from your village does not solve your problem. Until we have nationalistic leaders that do not look at their primordial ethnic interest, and they have the interest of serving the nation. And I think that's when that we'll be better served. All of this, the political class, just in the whim, how you came from nowhere. And you see now that some people have been parading this former PDP chairman and the governor of a senator from Borno State, and that later became the MPP, moved to PDP, became PDP chairman. I'm talking about Senator Modu Cherif. Some have been saying that he's the best candidate for the APC. So let's just watch out the game they are playing. Because we are just pawn in their political game. There's no difference in PDP or APC. They are the same. They are the same. Nigerian politicians are chameleon. So they change the color of their skin to the times and season and what suit them pattern. Let's just watch what is playing out. Because what has Ayu said to national discourse in the last 6 years, I'm asking you, what has he said? What statement? What conference? What speech? What has he done? We always imagine all of them put together, the AGP, any government in power.
All right, let's also still check out another. It's a security concern right here. The Daily Independent, six remaining Tucano jets delivered September 28th. And I remember that the United States, when making serious arguments, saying that it would help the Nigerian government in the fight against insurgents. And so how far do you think we have fared, with the fact that, yes, we have received the first batch of, the Tucano jets? How far have we fared battling all of these insurgents? And the fact that we're going to take delivery of the remaining six, that's the second batch, on the 28th of September, hopefully. What should we expect?
Wars are not only won on the battlefield. Wars are also won in you managing that information. If you check the Daily Trust story, Daily Trust said they broke the story 2 weeks ago about the death of the ISWAP leader, and the military just confirmed it. And in fighting this war, I think that the military needs to do much more better when it comes to its information management. It's critical in winning wars that people get to know what happened. We don't have to wait till eternity for us to understand. The military is doing very well, but what is, with respect to fighting banditry, with respect to fighting terrorism and the rest of it, but how often do we get information from the military with respect to what they are doing? How quickly? You see, what command structure do they put in place for sharing information with the public? And how transparent and how quickly do we share those information? Compare that to other crime, you get this news minute by minute of what the military is doing. So we have to wait in major events before the military makes statement concerning what they are doing. And if you don't make noise about what you are doing, nobody will know what you're doing. And I call it the N egg and the duck egg strategy. Let me just quickly talk about that. You see, the duck egg is the biggest. It is the most nutritious egg from a nutritional point of view. But nobody buys the duck egg. You only eat the hen egg. Because when the duck lays its egg, it lays it in secret. Whereas when the hen lays its egg, it lays it in the open. Everybody is aware. Because it's a because the hen makes noise about its own egg. That's what has made its own egg more valuable. Despite the fact that it is less nutritious than that of the duck. Which you... Have you eaten duck? Have you used duck egg to make omelette before? It's more nutritious, but it's of no value. It's the same thing with information management, communication management. So you must communicate. You cannot but not communicate. But for us in Nigeria, for government to communicate is wahala. For military to communicate is wahala. So even though when government is even doing something positive, people don't know and people assume. So assumption is the lowest level of intelligence. And because we assume that the military is not working, the government is not working, everything is not working, because they don't tell us. They are duck. And duck are dumb. And that's the problem.
All right. Jesus Johnson, when they leave their eggs. Well, let's go to the Daily Trust. One of the stories here says, Buhari seeks UNDP's intervention to resettle IDPs. It was one of the stories in the news yesterday. Where he reached out to the UNDP for support, you know, to, of course, make life better for internally displaced persons across northern Nigeria.
Wonderful. And then the U.S. donated them 3.5 million plus vaccines to Nigeria. So Nigeria is, we live by donation to solve our internal problem. It shows the approach which we have to offer things, and if we are requiring, and we said Nigeria is not in crisis. If they are internally, the indices of crisis shows that when you have large number of internally displaced persons within your country, and it shows things are not normal when it comes to security issues and protection of lives and property. Well, thank God for the UN agencies, the UN agencies for the intervention they are doing, but Nigeria is a giant of Africa. Should not be relying on UN agencies. In actual sense, we should be helping other African countries. Rather, it is just other African countries that should be benefiting from UNDP's program and not Nigeria, based on the resources we have and based on the image we project for ourselves. Now, if we project ourselves as the image of giant of Africa, and then we go out begging to solve our internal problems, it really shows that indeed we are not giant of Africa as we claim. Rather, we are turning to beggars of Africa. Looking to solve our problem. I don't think that we should be relying on these agencies to solve our problems. And people, money, resources that have been voted in the past for these IDPs, what has happened to it? The palliatives that were taken to these IDPs during COVID-19, what has happened to it? There are no prosecution of people that were budgetary allocations made for these IDPs that it has been judiciously used. And let me quickly tie that to the budget and the 2022 budget. The rep said that they are going to pass it by December 15th, and they are threatening MDs, ministries, departments, and agencies of government. Why would the rep be threatening them if they do the oversight function? If they do, what we see is that the budget are passed, but the budgets are not monitored to ensure that there is compliance with the budgetary provision. What is the level of budget execution?
Implementation.
And they don't do that. All they are keen about is when they come to present the budget, that's when you hear something about the rep and the National Assembly screaming blue murder. It is not about the time of passage of the budget. What we have achieved under advisor, we have passed budget before January or early in January. But what level of compliance have we gained with respect to executing what is stated in the budget? And that should be the focus of the National Assembly, not only timely passage of the budget, but also 100% compliance with the provisions of the budget.
Well, like you mentioned, you know, we are meant to be the giants of Africa, but, you know, it doesn't seem very much like that, you know, when you see what Nigerians themselves are currently dealing with, you know, and when you were speaking, I had to imagine, you know, if, you know, South Africa will be able to have the amount of internally displaced persons that Nigeria currently has, and what questions would be asked, you know, by the National Assembly in South Africa, you know, with regards to their government's efforts. I remember Malema, I think that's what it's called, and how he always, you know, is very vocal with criticizing government where they seem to be failing. But Nigeria has had these millions and millions of children and you know, internally displaced persons, and that we've continued to hear that billions have been directed towards, but they don't seem to be living a better life.
Yeah, we all you need to do is to just take a trip to this this camp and see. I remember I went for a program and in Ogun State, and I showed the people who went with the younger generation that, you know, that when there was crisis in Liberia or was in Ogun State, very close to Ijebu, and was where we had Liberian refugees, where they were camped. And I said, you know, that was where Alfonso Davis was giving birth to. He was giving birth to the guy that plays for Bayern Munich and that plays for Canada now. That, that's where they were camped. During the crisis in West Africa, we provided them shelter for a lot of refugees in Nigeria. Now, we're having crisis in Nigeria. We're not able to provide that. For me, that's done to a drain pipe. People are making money out of the misfortunes of others. That cannot be uncontroverted, because if you look at the amount of resources that has been budgeted and what is even much more than what you can use to finance a local government. And most of these people, where they have kept them, is not even up to a local government. And you wonder how we found ourselves in this situation, that we have to go cap in hand to UNDP, to give us money. Why would they give us money when they know that the bulk of the money they give to us might likely or probably go to private coffers? So for me, but going and begging, I don't think Nigeria needs to, with what God has done for us, with what God has blessed us with, I don't think we need UN to help us out, UNDP to help us out in solving the issue of internally displaced persons. One, the resources that are allocated for their territory, which is their local government, where does it go to? We found out that these state structures and state institutions that are meant to be in those areas are still there. They will still have local government chairman, they will have councillors, they will have the rest of it. When election comes, the figures will be taken from those areas to reflect that those people actually voted in the election. And now if those people actually participated in the political process as claimed, then you should make provisions for them economically, because politics who gets what, when, where, and how. So wherever they are, they should get the resources of the state, because the allocations that are made for their territory in terms of local government allocation, in terms of resources that are allocated to their states and to their territory by the federal government with respect to their representation in the country. But we only know who, we only know what, but we don't know how, whether they get it, and we don't know where. So if you apply David Easton's definition of politics, who gets what, when, where, and how, then definitely wherever they are, they should be able to be to get the resources that's allocated to them. But unfortunately, it is what it is. Like most Nigerians believe, you continue to pray to solve this problem, but it's sheer stupidity. It's an illusion for you to think that prayer will solve the problem that man can solve for us. Well, because if it's by prayer, Nigeria should be the most successful country in the world.
Yeah, it's pretty much the same, you know, situation. And of course, we have to wrap up here, but it's pretty much the same situation that we've spoken about over and over, and that is lack of auditing with regards to Nigeria's finances and the things that we spend money on. We've heard also about the school feeding program and how, you know, they claim to have spent billions in, you know, in feeding children across the country. Also, the COVID-19 palliatives and how much, you know, money Nigerian government claims to have spent, billions and billions of naira, but there's zero auditing as to whether these things were truly sent to the people that they were budgeted for. Sadly,
traders' money.
Yeah, exactly, and trader money.
Traders' money.
Gideonson, would have hopefully we would have an extended conversation about this. But thank you very much. We have to wrap up here.
The key is for us to restructure our system. We inherited a military system where there is a command structure, where you cannot question the military administrator, where you cannot question the president's finances. That's what has even been applied to security board. That's the system which we have. The auditor general cannot function under that system. So that takes us to what we need to put in the system. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be with you. Ensure that this evening you go out to catch some fun, relax, and don't let the stress of work take too much of you. And it's a pleasure to meet the beautiful lady in the studio.
Thank you so much.
And I last, and we are balanced it this week.
Thank you very much. Judy Johnson, have a great weekend. Thanks for joining
us. Thank you, Judy. Thank you.
All right, stay with us. We'll take a short break. When we come back, our first major conversation for today. Still talking elections. And of course, now we're talking direct primaries. How does this change the narrative of the Nigerian electoral space across the country? That comes up after the short break. Good morning.